Welcome back, I'm John with Keyframe Academy, and I am pumped for today's video. Today we're gonna be talking about DUIK Bassel. We all know DUIK Bassel for character rigging, but here's the thing, DUIK Bassel comes with all kinds of tools and utilities to help make your life easier. And unfortunately, a lot of these things never get talked about. They fly way under the radar. So my goal in this video is to spotlight five of those things. I'm gonna show you how to make your character rigs better. I'm gonna show you some tools that allow you to do some really cool things in DUIK Bassel. And I am hoping by the end of this video, at least one of these things is gonna blow your mind. So with that being said, let's get started. But before we get started, I want to shout out this video's sponsor, Envato Elements. In fact, all the character rigs I am using in this video came from Envato Elements. I found them and I downloaded them for this video. So you can have access to Envato Elements with unlimited downloads for a monthly subscription fee, or if you decide to go annual, you'll actually get it for half off, 50%. It's a huge discount. So if you're interested in Envato Elements and you wanna sign up, I'd appreciate it if you use my link in the description. That tells Envato Elements I sent you and it helps support the channel. So go check that out. Now let's get on to tip number one. Tip number one, simplify your DUIK rig and skip the structure layers. If you're like me, the way you learned to rig with DUIK was to use the structure layers that you overlaid on your art layers that you then parented your art layers to in order to rig everything up. This process can get confusing simply because of the sheer amount of layers that pile up in your timeline just for one character.
Two character rigs in one composition? Forget about it.
The good news is that structure layers are actually completely optional. All you have to do is make sure that the anchor points of each layer are set correctly at each joint, then select your limb layers starting from the bottom. So in the case of this arm, I'll select the hand layer first, then make my way up the arm. If you're rigging up a leg, you'd start from the foot. With all three layers of your limb selected, you can just hit auto rig and DUIK will rig up the limb. Now there are some caveats to this. For example, rigging up a leg this way will not give you all the controls for the foot. So if you need those, you might have to do it the old fashioned way. Then all I do now is parent the arm and hand controllers to my body and the thigh layers to my body, and I've got a working rig. As you can see, skipping the structure layers dramatically reduces the number of layers and makes it way easier to sift through all these different layers in your timeline.
Later on in this video, I'll show you how DUIK can help you simplify your character rigs even further.
Tip number two, animate parenting. Did you know that DUIK has a tool right here called Parent Constraint, which allows you to keyframe the parenting of a layer? So in this example, I have the axe handle switch between three different parent layers, and in some parts, it's not parented to any layer. It starts parented to the right hand controller. Then when it is in the air, it's not parented to anything. Then it is parented to the left hand controller for the catch and the reeling back. And then as it flies through the air, it's no longer parented to anything. And then as soon as it hits the target, it is parented to the target shape layer. I'll show you how this works with this example. Here I have two hands and I want this ball to be tossed through the air to the other hand. I've already gone ahead and animated the hands, one throwing and the other catching. Now I just need to parent the ball to each hand at the appropriate time. First, I'll go to the first frame of my composition and make sure the ball is placed at its starting point. With the ball layer selected, I'll come over to DUIK and click Parent Constraint, which will add some options in the effects panel. Here in the effects panel, I will select the layer I want it to parent to. In this case, the layer labeled left hand. Underneath this drop-down menu, you'll see weight. The weight is what you use to keyframe the parenting on and off. 0 means no parenting, 100% means full parenting. Because I want the ball to start out in the left hand, I'll leave the weight at 100%. I'll scrub to where I want the ball to fly out of the hand, create a keyframe, and then I'll advance one frame by using page down on my keyboard, and I'll create a keyframe for 0% weight. At this point, the ball is no longer parented to any layer. Next, I'll hit P to bring up the position of my ball layer, and I'll create a keyframe. Then I'll scrub to where the right hand catches the ball and place the ball in the right hand. Then I'll add a keyframe as close to the middle of this motion path as possible, and I'll create this arcing motion of the ball. I'll make some adjustments to the easing and the arc of the path. Then with the ball layer selected, I'll go over to DUIK and click on parent constraint again, which will add another instance of the parent constraint in the effects control panel. In this second instance, I'll click the drop down menu and I'll select the right hand and I'll create a keyframe for the weight. I'll hit page up to go to the previous frame and I'll set the weight to 0. Now as I play it back, I should see the ball toss from the left hand to the right hand. Now, I should mention that your mileage may vary with this tool. It does seem to have a little bit of an issue, and you may have noticed it in the example of the axe throwing, and you might have spotted it in this one. For some reason, when using the multi-parenting tool, it doesn't render every frame correctly. It glitches out on some frames randomly, and I don't really know why this is. So, if you have an answer, please let me know in the comments, and I will pin your comment. It is more noticeable at lower frame rates, so if you're someone like me who likes to animate at 12 frames per second, this might be a deal breaker for you. It's a lot less noticeable at higher frame rates, like 24 and 30. Tip number 3, use custom control layers in place of the null layers.
Obviously, this isn't the most groundbreaking tip in this list, but I included it because staying organized throughout a project is key in maintaining productivity.
Using these control layers helps you to stay organized because they are little icons that can tell you exactly what they are controlling. Let me show you an example of what I mean. Here I have a hand rig that I built, and at the base of each finger I have a control layer that I have rigged up to a rotation property that controls the spread of the fingers. I could have just used nulls here, but I chose to use these controllers because the icon tells me that they control the rotation value. So visually, I instantly know what these controllers are used for. So here's another example. With this character from tip number 1, I want to create a controller for the body. I'll start by selecting the body layer in my timeline, and then because I'll be animating both the position and the rotation of the body, I'll click on this controller icon.
Doesn't actually matter which icon you use. You could choose the hip icon if you wanted.
When I click on the icon, it will be created perfectly centered on the anchor point of the layer I had selected, in this case, my body layer. So now I should note that this is not the same as clicking on auto rig. You do have to manually parent your original layer to this new controller. So again, why use these over null layers? Well, there are a few benefits, in my opinion, in using these control layers over null layers. One is that the icon tells you something about what the layer is controlling. Second, the icons can be color-coded for further organization, and these layers are easier to spot than null layers. Third, these icons can be offset. So if you have an area with lots of different layers around and it's hard to select the exact layer you want, you can move it out of the way and it makes it easier to select. Or you can offset just to make your rigs less distracting. Now, there is one other reason you should absolutely be using these control layers for your character rigs, but we'll revisit that in tip number 5. Tip number 4, connectors can drive any property using any other property. Connectors in DUIK allow you to drive the animation between two keyframes using the value of just about any other property you want. So for example, you can control the opacity of one layer with the rotation of another layer. So as you rotate that layer, the more visible that other layer becomes. Here I have a real world example of how I use this connector on a rig. I've rigged up this arm using DUIK's auto rig feature. Watch what happens to the bicep as I bend the arm. Using this connector, I've connected the size of my bicep to the rotation of the forearm. Now let's show you how I set this up. Here's the same rig, but without the connector set up. With my bicep layer selected, I'll hit U on my keyboard to bring up all the keyframes on that layer. On the first frame, I have a keyframe for the shape of the bicep when the arm is completely straight. This is the minimum. On the second frame, I have the keyframe for the shape of the bicep when the arm is bent. This is the maximum. Usually keyframes are used to animate with, but in this case, we're using these keyframes, or rather, DUIK will be using these keyframes as a marker or reference for the minimum and maximum values of the rotation of our forearm.
Now this will make more sense in a moment when we set everything up.
Also, I've added this line here that I want to become more visible as the arm bends and the bicep gets bigger, adding to the illusion that the bicep is bulging out of the arm. I'll add a trim path to this shape group. I'll add keyframes to the start and end value, and then I'll shift these keyframes over one frame to the second frame by hitting Alt and the right arrow. I want this line to be fully visible at the maximum angle of the elbow. That is why I was shifting these keyframes over to the second frame. Then on the first frame, I'll set both the start and end values to 50% because I want this line to be drawn on from the middle.
If you're having trouble understanding what I mean, it'll all make sense when it's all connected.
Now I'll deselect this layer, but I'll keep these properties open. I'll select my forearm and I'll hit R to bring up the rotation property because we're going to be using this rotation property to drive the change in our bicep. So I'll select the rotation property, and in DUIK, I'll click this little circle next to the connector option, which will open up this other screen. Then I'll click property, which will load in the selected property, in this case, the rotation property. You'll know that it's loaded in right because we'll see the degrees in the minimum and maximum. By default, the minimum is set to 0 and the maximum is set to 100. These two values represent the two columns of keyframes we made on the first and second frames of the bicep layer. This means at 0 degrees of rotation, our bicep will look like it does on frame 1, and at 100 degrees rotation, the bicep will look like it does on frame 2. Any values between 0 and 100 will be a blend between these two states of keyframes. Okay, so with the right property loaded in, we now need to select the properties on the bicep layer that we keyframed, the shape path and the trim path's start and end values. Go back to DUIK and click on Connect Properties. Once you do that, there will be a new connector layer. And now, when we bend the arm rig, you'll see that the bicep is connected to the rotation of the forearm. On the connector layer, I can adjust the minimum and maximum value. So if I want the bicep to be fully enlarged when the arm is bent at a 90 degree angle instead of 100 degrees, I can change the maximum to 90 degrees. I'll leave the minimum set to 0 degrees. So any rotational values between 0 and 90 degrees will result in a blend between the two different states that we keyframed on our bicep layer. The connector is an awesome tool and it can be used in a lot of fun ways. You can even use it to connect properties to a position property like I've done with this character rig that I built using Limber. I love Limber because I have full control over my limb. In this example, I've connected the size of the knee to the Y position of my body so that as the body goes down, the knee gets larger as if it's extending towards the camera rather than extending out to the side like this knee on the left, creating the illusion of foreshortening. Now, jumping back to our arm example, one other thing I want to mention is that if you want to make adjustments, all you have to do is disable the expressions on the keyframe properties, make your changes, then re-enable your expressions, and you won't break the connector.
Now, remember how I said in the first tip that I was going to show you another way to further simplify your character rigs? Well, I'm here to deliver on that promise. I've left this tip to the last, not because it's necessarily the most mind-blowing, but because in my opinion, it's by far the most useful tool DUIK has to offer, and I want to reward you for making it this far into the video.
With DUIK, I can extract just the controller layers to animate a character inside their own comp. So here I have two character rigs in one composition. And even if we use tip number one and skip the structure layers, we'd still end up with tons of layers in our timeline. So instead, I've built these character rigs out in their own compositions and then placed those compositions into the current composition. I'll select this character rig on the right and go over to DUIK and select Extract. DUIK will work its magic, and now I have all the controller layers in the current composition, while all the shapes that make up my character remain inside the original composition. This massively reduces the number of layers in my timeline and makes animating my characters so much easier.
And if that isn't cool enough, here is why I say that this tool is the most useful DUIK has to offer, and why I think even if you don't like to use DUIK for character rigging, this tool alone is reason enough to have DUIK installed on your machine.
You might recognize this guy on the left. I didn't use DUIK to rig him up, I used Limber instead. But despite this not being a DUIK rig, I can still use DUIK to extract the controllers. I just have to go in and tell DUIK which layers I want it to extract. So I'll go into this composition and I'll select the controller layers that I want to extract. In this case, I want to select the wrist controller layers and the foot layers. Then I'll go over to DUIK and I'll click tag, which will tag these layers as controller layers. In this particular case, I need to then select just my foot layers and go up to layer and turn off guide layers. Otherwise, they won't be visible when I do my final render. I'll leave all the other controller layers as guide layers. Now, when I go back to my other comp and hit extract, DUIK will bring over all the controller layers I just tagged, even though they belong to Limber. And what is awesome is that I still have access to my Limber properties. So if I want to modify any of these properties to modify my limbs, I still can. Now I have two character rigs in the same comp and I have less layers to deal with in my timeline than if I had just one character in here. Also, you'll notice that the controller I created for the body, which we talked about in tip number 3, also came over when I extracted because those controller layers are tagged as controller layers by DUIK by default. That's why I said you should absolutely be using these controller layers if you're doing character animation. Otherwise, I wouldn't be able to animate the position and the rotation of the bodies of these characters individually if I didn't have these controllers to extract.
Okay, so that does it for today's video. Did you learn anything new? Did you have anything that blew your mind? Let me know in the comment section below. And if you found that this video was helpful, hit that like button. It really helps in the YouTube algorithm. And if you want more content like this in the future, make sure you're subscribed because I got more coming. And we got some really fun videos coming up. So make sure you have that bell icon turned on so that you're notified when I post a new video. Thanks for watching and we'll see you guys in the next video.